I'm trying to think of which number this is. Is it the pulpit mic? Pull the slide down. Thank you. Because this mic and this mic are feeding the bed. Thank you. I'm not going to keep you long. Oh, well, let's turn mine down. This is the wireless. Thank you. All right, that's good. Still very good. I'm not going to keep you long. And we just want to thank the Lord for what he's doing among us. And for Geneva Jenkins.
Yes.
Amen. We want to thank the Lord for that gift to our church. I want to talk with you briefly about going on to maturity. Okay? Now, I'm glad if you have come to Jesus, I'm glad. But it doesn't stop there, because we are called to not just become converts. We are called to be disciples. Amen? We are called to go on to maturity, to launch out into the deeper waters. And I'm going to point you to the fifth chapter of the book of Hebrews. We'll start at verse 7. I have it on the screen. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who can save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Well, that's a part of maturity, the reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. And he was designated by God to be high priest in the order of Melchizedek. And we have much to say about this. Then he goes on to say, but it is hard to explain because you are slow to learn. It's like, as the kids say, dang, Paul. Wait, what? Did you have to go on such a negative note there? You were doing so well. You were sounding so noble. So scriptural, so biblical. And then he just kind of turns it off with, I have much to say about this, but you guys aren't the sharpest knife in the drawer. Recognize verse 11. Verse 12 says, in fact, though by this time, you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. See, now he's explaining what he meant by you're slow to learn. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, still being an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Therefore, let us leave the elementary teachings about Christ and go on to maturity. And as he had really great things to say. He was a little perturbed by the fact that they hadn't grown up. They were still spiritual children. Amen. Amen. What makes people not grow up in the faith? Well, when it comes to how the kingdom runs, we are to submit to him. Okay, the kingdom, it's a kingdom because it has a king. And there's only room for one king. Not a king, not several kings and a queen. Queen or two or three or four. But one king. And the thing that holds us back from going on to maturity is saying, yes, I am a part of the kingdom, but I want things my way. Okay? And you just stomp on the brakes and stop growing right there. Because part of the kingdom is about being submitted to the king. We're all called to grow up in faith. And let me say that those who won't grow up won't go on. Those who don't grow up eventually become those who fall away when the going gets tough. And if the going hasn't gotten tough for you yet, just wait a minute. Okay? You know what I'm talking about? The world has a saying. It says, if it ain't one thing, it's another. Because sometimes there's always something to deal with. We're told that we're to go on to become those who can instruct others in the faith, reproducing disciples. Yeah, Paul said that in verse 12. Remember, we just read that. In fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you still need someone to teach you the elementary truth of God's word. Now, God has a purpose for our lives, that you all heard that. And we are called to have goals for our lives, and those goals are to match up with his purposes. His purpose for our lives is for us to come into maturity so that we can be used. We only start to come into maturity where we can be used when we come to the realization that he is the Lord and it's all about him. Okay, let me say that again. He is the Lord and it's all about him. It's not about us. Amen. It's all about him. Okay, now don't say amen. And say, yeah, amen, but that's not the way I want. Because it's got to be all about him. Amen. Now, let your goals be fitting for his purposes. Now, the way people are, we can have goals that are immature and goals that reflect maturity. Okay. What do you mean by that, Pastor Bill? Well, for instance, a few examples of the goals of the immature. The immature want to have a religious identification. Okay, they want to identify with their faith, or maybe with the church. The immature often go to church to relieve a religious conscience because God is always tapping on someone's shoulder. And that's the grace of God, saying, come to me. Saying, come to me. The The immature have yet to really submit to God. And because of what? Because of the fact that they haven't really submitted to God. They talk to talk. And they can be nice and churchy. Isn't Jesus wonderful? Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. I had a lady one time, I was out there riding the tractor. That's what I just thought, I just had to crack up and say, what's he laughing about? I'm going to tell you what I'm laughing about. I was out there riding the tractor, the lawnmower, and this lady had lived up the street, had this big yard that was all overgrown with trees and stuff, and said, Pastor, could you come down with that and cut my yard there beside my house? And I said, well, where is it? I'll go down and have a look at it. And she said, Pastor, I really need you to cut it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Glory, thank you, Jesus. And she's sitting behind the wheel. And she started this, oh, thank you, Jesus. And I said, she's doing this to try to sway me and impress me. You know, I'm thinking, seriously? The funny part is that she was serious. She was seriously trying to persuade me with that religious nonsense. Okay? She was serious. And I'm saying this under the heading of the immature that have some sort of religious identification that they think that they pull out of their pocket and flop out on the desk from time to time and think it serves them best. Okay? The immature have yet to really submit to God because of this. They're not very teachable. This is why Jesus often said, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. And he said that knowing that everybody doesn't have ears to hear. Even those who claim Christ, just because of where they are in their own walk with God and their level of submission. Those of the immature, they can look something like the goals of a tour, because we all want God's blessing, don't we?
Yes.
Yes. The Lord knows I do. I need God's blessing. But the immature, that's the big goal, just to be blessed. They often want God's blessing, but they don't want to stop sinning. Hello. They still want to do things their way. And they go through little religious rituals for blessing, give God's blessing, light this candle, okay? Give this offering. Do this, take some blessed water and sprinkle it. Okay, you know what I'm talking about? Okay, we can get kind of crazy with this kind of stuff. Salt, oil, water. Take some salt and throw it over your shoulder. Turn around three times. And say the Lord's Prayer. Have mercy on your people. goals of being tour, and it's, now this is a good goal, is to miss hell. Okay? Now, I don't blame them for that one. I'm gonna miss hell too. They say hell is the one barbecue you don't want to be invited to. Hell is for volunteers. Nobody has to go. Jesus made a way. But the immature person's goal is to miss hell, and they're the Christian who comes to Christ simply because they're looking for fire insurance. They're not really interested in walking with God. They just don't want to go to hell. Okay. And that is reflected in their lives by the question they may ask out loud or in their hearts quietly. How little do I have to do to miss hell? And I don't want to be super religious. I do all that. I don't think anybody has to be sitting up in church every Sunday. Yeah, I've had people say that to me. And it's not that God is laying some big trip on us, but He wants us to come and worship. He wants to be a priority in our lives. Now, enough of the goals of the immature. Let's look at briefly the goals of the mature. The goals of the mature. Simple. To be like Jesus. Now, make that your goal. Now, you may not know what all that means right now, to be like Jesus. But if that's your prayer, Lord, help me to be like you. The Lord will open it up for you, and you'll start to be like Him in the way you see things, and especially in the way you see others. You start to see people with love. You start to see their need. Okay. And you can see people who are no good, crooked, and vile. People on the street who are to be avoided. And they're out there. Okay? You see them across the street. It's real. However, you see their need. And they need Jesus. When we are trying to be like Jesus, part of being like Jesus is having a made up mind. Not doubting whether, do I really want to do this? When it comes to my faith, my Christianity, yeah, I want to do this. I'm not going to do anything else. I belong to Him. He died for me. I have been bought with a price. I am not my own. Have a made up mind. And let that be part of your prayer. Lord, help me to have a made up mind. The goal, one of the goals of the immature, of the mature is to stop looking back. Okay? Jesus saved us. It says, for He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of His Son that He loves. The idea that we have been rescued from the dominion of darkness, don't look back into the darkness. Long for, wish for. There's no looking back. no turning back.
Yeah.
Don't have one foot in, one foot out. One foot in the church, one foot out there in the world. Straddling the fence. One foot on this side, one foot on that side. Have I made up mine? Get both feet on this side. And probably one of the biggest things, goals for the mature is the conquering of self. Okay? Because who gives you the hardest time when it comes to walking with God and doing what's right all the time? You. You give yourself the hardest time. Well, the Lord's talking to you, heart. Well, this is my will for your life, and this is the best way. This is the way of blessing. Self says, yeah, and maybe I'll do that sometime. But right now, I'm going to do this. Kids, especially young kids who are teenagers, maybe in their early 20s, will tell you, yeah, I know I need to come to Jesus and give my life to Him and serve Him and I'm going to do that one day. But for right now, I'm young. I just want to have fun. And they just put it out there. Right now, self is more important on my priority list. And the devil didn't let him see that you can have fun in the Lord. Matter of fact, the Bible says the joy of the Lord is your strength. There is joy in walking with the Lord. There is fun in the spirit where you can have a good time in your heart and enjoy the things around you without doing this and that and this. Okay? Okay. I'll be having fun. I mean, y'all know too much about that. Help us, Jesus. Okay? You don't need that joint or whatever to have fun. Or whatever it is, or whatever it is. Lord, I lay me down before you. I lay me down. Lord, I submit to you. The conquering of self. That's what we're talking about. The conquering of self. Lord, I lay me down. Lord, I have prayed this many times. Lord, forgive me. Lord, I lay my life down again, and forgive me for the time that I laid it down and picked it up. I laid it down. I belong to you. I don't want to belong to me. Lord, in the times when where I'm having trouble conquering self, Lord, those are the times I'm being a fool because I want to walk with you. Hey, be honest, be real before the Lord, and He will help you conquer self. The goals of the mature, pleasing the Father. Lord, I want this to bring you pleasure. I want to do what's right in your eyes. I want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. I don't want to hear, well, you're okay. You don't get a well done, but I guess you can come in. Okay? I want to be pleasing to the Lord.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And just as I started talking about goals number two, about the thing I'm loving others, I want the heart that loves others. Okay, now let me say, want that. Because the devil is trying hard to work within us, to cultivate and mold within us a heart that doesn't care for others. A heart that just says, that's your problem. Rather than a heart that is led to be a blessing. The opposite of love is not hate. It's indifference. It's just, I can care less. You don't have to hate them, just don't give a rip. Okay? The goals of the mature, we want to own his emphasis. What God's emphasis is, and is laid out in the Word. It says he is the head of the body, the church. Own his church. Own it. Make the church yours. The church has to be a part of your life. Okay. And this gets us away from just the religious thing. I said, well, I've got to go to church every Sunday. Well, you should go to worship once a week. Yes, you should. But why? Because you're owning God's priority, and he is the head of the body. In the church, the church isn't the building, is it the church gathered? That's what this is. The church gathered. Church together. We are the church. People say, well, I don't need church. They put you in the immature column. Yes, you do. Church is where you learn to walk with God. Church is where you learn to interact with others in the kingdom. The church is a little working model of the kingdom of God. That's what it's supposed to be. Okay. And if you want to learn to function well in the kingdom, you need to learn to function well in the church. If you can't get along with people in the church, they might not like you in heaven. Okay, I'm telling you. And as I've heard it said so wonderfully, don't say that God is your father if the church is not your mama. All right. Own his desires. And he desires to save. You know, we can listen to all sorts of Christian teaching and preachers on TV, and the church is about wanting to save souls. Stop people from going to hell. The hemorrhage, this world is hemorrhaging souls. Amen. His desire to disciple. So let me say this. Because I said I would preach on it. We want to be like Jesus. We want to own his emphasis. And we want to identify with Jesus' nationality. Okay? What does that mean? Well, in this day and age of racial emphasis and racial divide, and Black Lives Matter and All Lives Matter and all this mess. You know, it's like, wow. I want to identify with Jesus' nationality. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean I should now claim to be a Sephardic Jew? No. I will point you to three quick scriptures to say what that means. Philippians 3, verse 20. Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's Jesus' nationality. He is about heaven. Okay? That's where your citizenship is from. That's where you belong. That's your home. That is the capital of your country. Heaven.
Grandma's sauce.
1 Peter 2:9. It says, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. That is our nationality. We are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a holy nation. Let us live our lives and desire to live our lives as those who are chosen and a royal priesthood. Beautiful, a royal priesthood. And that priesthood tells us that God is making us to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God. Okay, and now, this is part of your understanding for walking in maturity. So, as I bring this to a close, are you growing in faith?
Yes.
Amen. Then, do you have a made-up mind?
Yes.
I mean, a mind made up to walk with God. No playing around, stop monkeying around with religion and walk with Jesus. Are you changing? Are you becoming like Jesus? So the changing is the thing. When you walk with God for a while, He starts changing you in here. You find that you are changing inside. The things that you used to love, the things that weren't right, you find that you don't care for those anymore. They rub you the wrong way now. You used to love them. Are you changing? If you're not changing, uh-oh. If you can still enjoy the same old junk you were into 10 years ago, I got to look at you like this. Are you owning His priorities? And His priorities are people. His priorities are not legalistic religious stuff. His priorities are not ladies whether or not you got on a dress or pants. Okay. That's silliness. That's not God's priority. His priority of people. And bringing them to Him. Loving them and redeeming them. That priority is so tough for the Lord. He died for it. Amen? Let's pray. Father, help us to love You. Help us to walk in maturity. Help us to walk in maturity. Lord, forgive us for the immaturity we walked in, and help us to grow up. And Lord, help us to love the people. Help us to claim Your priorities. Help us to love people. become more like Jesus. Lord, help us with our focus on self, because sometimes, Lord, we can be kind of wishy-washy. Help us, Lord. Because we want to be like Jesus. Help us grow in faith. Help us to walk in maturity. And Lord, if there are any here who have not yet submitted their life to Jesus, do that now. I encourage you to pray in Jesus' name. Say, Lord, forgive me. Wash over me. Wash me in your blood. Cleanse me from my sins. And help me to live for you. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Now, if you just prayed that prayer for the first time, we'd like to encourage you. I want to encourage you. Well, let me know. I've got some stuff for you to help you walk with God. That's what's important. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's go.